It's Wednesday, August 21st. I'm Max Pringle with Scott Baba. It's day three of the Democratic National Convention in Chicago. Minnesota Governor Tim Walz is set to formally accept his party's nomination for vice president tonight. Former President Bill Clinton and other speakers are also on tonight's list. Former President Obama and former First Lady Michelle Obama headlined Tuesday's festivities with powerful addresses in support of Vice President Kamala Harris's candidacy. Protests accompanied the DNC in Chicago, leading to dozens of arrests at an anti-war demonstration in front of the Israeli consulate in Chicago on Tuesday. Ukraine launches drone attacks in Russia as it seeks to solidify its gains in the Kursk region of Russia. And California Democrats are divided over State Proposition 36 on the November ballot, which seeks to increase penalties on certain drug crimes and other felonies. These stories and more are coming up from the studios of KPFA in Berkeley. I'm Max Pringle with Scott Baba. Minnesota Governor Tim Walz will headline tonight's Democratic National Convention in Chicago as he accepts the nomination of his party as Vice President Harris's vice presidential running mate. Until Harris named Walz as her partner on the ticket, Walz was a relative unknown outside of his home state of Minnesota. More from Sagar Magani.
Vice presidential nominee Tim Walz faces dual tasks during tonight's address at the Democratic Convention. Much of the nation doesn't know who Walz is, and campaign spokesman Michael Tyler says tonight is the Minnesota governor's chance to tell them.
A wider swath of the electorate is going to have the opportunity to fully understand and get to know who Governor Walz is.
But on a night whose theme is a fight for our freedoms, Walz will also have to transition the convention. From last night's party atmosphere to the campaign's central theme, that another Donald Trump term would endanger American democracy and liberties on things including reproductive rights. Walz's own statements about starting a family via IVF are under scrutiny. His wife clarified yesterday she did not undergo the procedure, as he has repeatedly claimed, but instead used other fertility treatments. A campaign spokeswoman says Walz was just using common shorthand for the treatments, but Republican vice presidential counterpart J.D. Vance accuses Walz of lying. Sagar Magani, Washington.
Former President Bill Clinton will also address the Democratic National Convention tonight. Clinton's speech follows that of former President Barack Obama and former First Lady Michelle Obama, both of whom spoke yesterday. The speeches made by both Obamas warned of a hard fight ahead and called on the nation to embrace Kamala Harris in urgent messages that were at times both hopeful and ominous. Michelle Obama spoke before her husband and praised the principles instilled in Kamala Harris.
Even though our mothers grew up an ocean apart, they shared the same belief in the promise of this country. That's why her mother moved here from India at 19. It's why she taught Kamala about justice, about the obligation to lift others up, about our responsibility to give more than we take. She'd often tell her daughter, "Don't sit around and complain about things. Do something."
Michelle Obama said that Harris has worked hard to reach her position, and as a result, she understands the struggles of everyday Americans. This in implied comparison to Harris's opponent in the presidential race.
If we bankrupt a business or choke in a crisis, we don't get a second, third, or fourth chance. If things don't go our way, we don't have the luxury of whining or cheating others to get further ahead. No. We don't get to change the rules so we always win. If we see a mountain in front of us, we don't expect there to be an escalator waiting to take us to the top. No.
The former First Lady also warned against the danger of Democrats losing sight of what really matters in the election and returning to old self-destructive patterns.
We cannot be our own worst enemies. No. See, because the minute something goes wrong, the minute a lie takes hold, folks, we cannot start wringing our hands. We cannot get a Goldilocks complex about whether everything is just right. And we cannot indulge our anxieties about whether this country will elect someone like Kamala instead of doing everything we can to get someone like Kamala elected.
Barack Obama made the case for Harris's candidacy, touting her record as a prosecutor, a senator, and as vice president of the United States.
As vice president, she helped take on the drug companies to cap the cost of insulin, lower the cost of health care, give families with kids a tax cut. And she is running for president with real plans to lower costs even more and protect Medicare and Medicaid and sign a law to guarantee every woman's right to make her own health care decisions.
The former president also spent much of his speech on a call for unity. He noted that increasingly in American politics, it has become normalized to reject the attack and attack anyone who does not share every single ideological principle.
Now, that approach may work for the politicians who just want attention and thrive on division. But it won't work for us to make progress on the things we care about, the things that really affect people's lives. We need to remember that we've all got our blind spots and contradictions and prejudices, and that if we want to win over those who aren't yet ready to support our candidates, we need to listen to their concerns and maybe learn something in the process.
Earlier in the day, Vermont Independent Senator Bernie Sanders also spoke. He called for an end to the war in Gaza and a national wealth tax.
These oligarchs tell us we shouldn't tax the rich. The oligarchs tell us we shouldn't take on price gouging. We shouldn't expand Medicare to cover dental, hearing, and vision. And we shouldn't increase Social Security benefits for struggling seniors. Well, I've got some bad news for them. That is precisely what we are going to do.
Meanwhile, dozens of people were arrested after clashing with police at an unpermitted anti-Middle East war protest outside the Israeli consulate in Chicago yesterday night. The National Lawyers Guild Chicago said at least 72 people were arrested during that protest, while police said 56 people, including three journalists, were arrested after refusing to follow multiple dispersal orders. The protests were planned to coincide with the Democratic National Convention, and Garrison reports.
The protesters were joined by three members of Naturi Karta, which means Guardians of the City, an Orthodox Jewish group holding signs denouncing the Israeli state and its war in Gaza. Here's Rabbi David Weiss, spokesman for the group.
And we're here in Chicago now by the Democratic Convention because we plead with the political leaders that they should stop being intimidated, they should stop supporting something which common sense dictates that it is unjust, that it is ungodly.
Earlier in the day, Medea Benjamin and several other members of Code Pink were dragged out of a room where Vice Presidential nominee Tim Walz was speaking to the Democratic Women's Caucus at McCormick Place.
We need to stop harming Israel. We still have a chance to stop the $23 billion that is on its way.
In Chicago, for Pacifica, KPFA Radio, I'm Ann Garrison.
Meanwhile, former President Donald Trump and his vice presidential running mate, Ohio Senator J.D. Vance, held a rally today with supporters in the battleground state of North Carolina. Trump held his first outdoor rally since narrowly surviving an attempted assassination last month. The podium was surrounded by plexiglass. The theme of the rally was national security. Trump said the country is less safe since President Biden and Vice President Harris took office.
Under my leadership, we rebuilt the United States military, created Space Force, and we made our allies pay their fair share and their fair dues.
J.D. Vance said Vice President Harris's policies at the border have made the country less secure.
If we give Kamala Harris a promotion and make her the president of the United States, the southern border is going to look like Walmart on Black Friday, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to be no good.
Trump and Vance are crisscrossing battleground states this week as part of their effort to break through coverage of the Democratic National Convention this week in Chicago. Securing Midwestern states' electoral votes is going to be critical in this November's election. And delegates from those states have been in Chicago this week at the DNC, trying to boost the Harris-Waltz campaign's momentum in those states. Joe Ullery reports on Indiana's participation.
Allen County Democratic Party Chairman Derek Camp is at the convention as a delegate. He says Hoosier voters are concerned about ensuring women's reproductive rights.
One of the things I hear the most back home in Indiana is reproductive rights. A woman's right to choose, as well as birth control, those are very important and high on minds of a lot of voters back home in Indiana. It's certainly something that Donald Trump has made clear that he's going to remove.
Camp sees voter enthusiasm growing in Indiana, especially among young people who are stepping forward to get involved, knocking on doors, and becoming party precinct chairs. Camp says he hasn't seen this kind of energy in Indiana since 2008, when President Barack Obama was elected to his first term. It was also the first time since 1964 that Indiana chose a Democrat for president. But while the historic nomination of Kamala Harris at the top of the Democratic ticket sizzles, Camp says Democrats are also thankful for the years of service from President Joe Biden.
What he also has done and has shown yet again is he's got a decade of service to his country and to his community, and by understanding that the best thing for this country is him stepping aside and passing the baton to his very capable Vice President Harris, who will make history herself.
The Indiana delegation is being led by former U.S. Senator Joe Donnelly, who recently stepped down as U.S. Ambassador to the Holy See. By the close of the four-day convention, Indiana's 88 delegates will have played a key role in nominating Vice President Kamala Harris and Minnesota Governor Tim Walz as the Democratic candidates for the 2024 presidential election. I'm Joe Ullery, Public News Service.
Native Americans attending this week's Democratic National Convention in Chicago are looking to find ways to increase Native voter participation and increase their community's electoral power. More from Antonia Gonzalez.
Tribal leaders and Native vote organizers say they're working to protect Native voting rights and are reaching out to people in their tribal communities, encouraging them to vote. Governor of the Gila River Indian Community, Stephen Rolua, says he's an advocate for his people. At the convention this week, the leader was seen holding his cell phone and sending a video message out on social media to his community.
That's going back home. That's going back to the Gila River Indian community and all, hopefully all of the 22 tribes in Arizona. As we know, the Native vote is going to be critical, especially in Arizona, the battleground state as well.
After listening to a panel on the Native vote 2024, Gina Katkak, chairwoman of the Menominee Indian Tribe of Wisconsin, says she sees the value in talking to community members about voting.
To make sure that we get them to the polls, looking at that younger generation, the 18 to 24-year-olds, having them engaged and participating, just really encouraging that message to get out and vote and to make sure that our voices are being heard.
Debbie Nez-Manuel, Arizona DNC committeewoman, says it's helpful attending the convention, where she's hearing and learning about Native vote efforts across the country and in her state.
This morning we heard from the Arizona Political Network that Montana produced over 60,000 voters, and that was really powerful.
Executive Director of the Native Organizers Alliance, Judith LeBlanc, says her group's efforts are on the grassroots level.
We've been organizing since dirt. We know how to organize. We do know what the problems are. So what we need is the opportunity to voice those during the election, because guess what? On election day, that's a snapshot of the organized power of our communities.
LeBlanc says the Native vote contributes to building healthy and safe tribal communities. I'm Antonia Gonzalez.
Key Middle East ceasefire negotiations mediator Egypt is expressing skepticism about the U.S.-backed proposal meant to bridge gaps in ceasefire talks between Israel and Hamas. More details about the proposal have emerged a day before negotiations are expected to resume in Cairo. The challenges around the so-called bridging proposal appear to undermine the optimism for an imminent agreement that U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken carried into his latest Mideast visit this week. The White House says President Biden spoke with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu today with no immediate details on what he said. More from Charles de Ledesma.
Minister, how are you? Welcome to Doha. It's good to see you.
Secretary of State Antony Blinken meets Qatari Minister of State Mohammed bin Abdul Aziz Al Khulafi in Lusail Palace after his arrival in Doha on Tuesday evening. But on Wednesday, Blinken ended his ninth visit to the Middle East since the war in Gaza began without securing any major breakthrough for a ceasefire deal. He'd warned on Tuesday that time is of the essence, even as Hamas and Israel signal that challenges remain. Hamas has called the latest proposal presented to it as a reversal of what it agreed to previously and has accused the US of acquiescing to what it called new conditions from Israel. I'm Charles de Ledesma.
Russian authorities say Moscow has come under one of the largest Ukrainian drone attacks since Russia invaded Ukraine in 2022, and that it destroyed all of them. The attacks come as Ukraine continues to press its offensive into Russia's western Kursk region. Megumi Lim reports from Kyiv.
Ukrainian forces advanced 28 to 35 kilometers into Russia's Kursk region and were now in control of 93 settlements and more than 1,200 square kilometers of territory. Ukraine's surprise incursion into Russia began more than 2 weeks ago and has led to the evacuation of thousands of people on both sides of the border. President Zelensky said Ukraine was trying to create a buffer zone and to degrade Moscow's military potential. On Wednesday, authorities said evacuations were being planned for the 45 residents living in Ukraine's Sumy region, which borders the Kursk region. Officials said Russian forces have been pushed back from the border because of the incursion and artillery attacks have decreased, but airstrikes have intensified.
And that's Megumi Lim in Kyiv. Afghanistan's ruling Taliban's morality ministry dismissed more than 280 members of the security force for failure to grow a beard and detained more than 13,000 people in Afghanistan for what it called immoral acts in the past year. That's according to Taliban officials. Beards are required for men under the Taliban's strict interpretation of Islam. The Ministry for the Prevention of Vice and Propagation of Virtue said in its annual operations update that around half of those detained had been let go after 24 hours. It did not break down the type of the alleged offenses or gender of the detainees. The ministry told a press conference that it had destroyed more than 21,000 musical instruments in the past year and prevented thousands of computer operators from selling what it called immoral and unethical films in markets. The morality ministry has been criticized by human rights organizations and the United Nations for restrictions on women and inhibiting freedom of expression. The United Nations mission to Afghanistan has reported cases of morality ministry officials stopping and detaining women at times for a few hours for not meeting their interpretation of Islamic dress. Since retaking power in 2021, the Taliban has placed severe restrictions on women and girls, banning female schooling past grade 6 and barring them from most jobs. Meanwhile, the Taliban has barred United Nations-appointed Special Rapporteur Richard Bennett from entering the country. That's according to a Taliban spokesperson who spoke with reporters. The Taliban accused the human rights watchdog of, quote, spreading propaganda. Bennett was appointed by the United Nations Human Rights Council in 2022 to monitor Afghanistan's human rights situation after the Taliban took over the previous year. Bennett has previously said the Taliban's treatment of women and girls could amount to a crime against humanity. He's based outside of Afghanistan, but has visited several times to research the situation. In a statement, Bennett urged the Taliban to reverse their decision and said he would continue to engage with Afghans inside and outside the country. 3 years into their rule after foreign forces withdrew, the Taliban have not been formally recognized by any foreign government. Foreign officials, including Washington, have said the path towards recognition is stuck until the Taliban changes course on women's rights, having barred most girls over the age of 12 from schools and universities, banning women from parks, and stopping most long-distance travel by women without a male guardian. New government jobs numbers out today suggest that favorable job growth reported in recent months may have been slightly exaggerated. Caroline Malone reports.
Employers added about 174,000 jobs a month for the 12 months leading up to March. That's revising downwards previous estimates. It's part of a preliminary process in which surveys are reconciled to get more accurate numbers and will become official next year. It does show that strong jobs growth has been less strong than previously thought. There is potential vulnerability in the jobs market, which has been touted as secure. That'll likely impact the Federal Reserve decision on monetary policy as they consider inflation and job numbers.
The United Auto Workers and car company Stellantis have been locked in contentious discussions over reopening an Illinois factory complex, and the spat has made its way into the presidential race. It could even lead to a strike against the automaker. In a speech at the Democratic National Convention Monday night, UAW President Sean Fain accused Stellantis of reneging on promises to restart a now-closed assembly plant in Belvidere, Illinois.
Let me be clear. Stellantis must keep the promises they made to America in our union contract. And the UAW will take whatever action necessary at Stellantis or any other corporation to stand up and hold corporate America accountable.
The union won the reopening and contract talks last fall after striking at Stellantis, General Motors, and Ford. Stellantis said it stands by the commitment and it strongly objects to union allegations that it's violating the terms of the contract. Former Ambassador Nikki Haley has called for Taiwan's inclusion in the United Nations and the World Health Organization. Charles de Ledesma reports.
The former ambassador to the United Nations, Nikki Haley, has called for more international backing for Taiwan and a coordinated pushback against China's claims over the self-ruled democracy. She also wants the island state to be fully integrated into the UN, even though it's being blocked by China from representation in international bodies.
Taiwan's pandemic leadership proves that you deserve a global voice. Taiwan shouldn't just be in the WHO. Taiwan should be a full member in the United Nations.
Haley, who served at the UN under former President Donald Trump's administration, ran a year-long presidential campaign as a tough-on-China candidate before dropping out of the race in March. She's endorsed Trump in the November elections. I'm Charles Ledesma.
Communities across the country and around the world have experienced record-breaking heat this summer. And climate activists are directing their criticisms at companies that contribute to the fossil fuel industry. Edwin J. Vieira reports from New York.
Though New York's summer is winding down, climate change's impacts remain. This summer saw record high temperatures, which have only grown in the last decade. Reports show by 2050, the state is projected to experience more days with temperatures above 90 degrees. Climate activists have been protesting companies contributing to fossil fuel use, which leads to worsening climate impacts. Reverend Chelsea McMillan with Green Faith says New York's climate impacts resemble the national trend.
Last year, the skies turned orange due to wildfire smoke coming down from Canada, and we are going to see more and more of these climate disasters happening in our state and in New York City.
While extreme heat is one of the deadliest elements of climate change, storm damage is one of the costliest. Hurricane Beryl was one of several storms to flood New York communities this year. All told, New York has seen around $23 billion in damage from billion-dollar disasters this year. Taxpayers were forced to pick up the $2 billion price tag for climate change costs in 2023. However, the Climate Change Superfund Act would require companies who've contributed to climate change to bear some adaptation infrastructure investment costs. But McMillan and other activists are protesting banks that finance fossil fuel projects. She says Citibank is one of the biggest contributors.
Citibank has poured almost $400 billion into oil, gas, and coal companies since the Paris Climate Accords in 2016. And this is just unconscionable. Like, there's no way we can meet any of our climate goals if we keep putting money into fossil fuels.
While Citibank has been the top financier of expansion for fossil fuel companies since 2016, JPMorgan Chase contributed the most financing to fossil fuel companies last year. Since the Paris Climate Accord, JPMorgan has invested more than $430 billion in fossil fuel projects and companies. Edwin J. Vieira reporting.
A Rapid City, South Dakota health clinic serving Native American women has reopened its doors after more than a year in hiatus. Lee Strubinger reports.
The clinic hadn't seen patients since April of 2023. A report from last year pointed to staffing issues leading to a large drop in appointments starting in 2021. Clinic officials say it offers OBGYN services, prenatal care, and STI testing. It will still refer deliveries to Monument Health. The clinic has hired a midwife and registered nurse. Clinic director Waisha Whiteface says patients should schedule appointments immediately.
And as fast as you can, because we announced last week that we were opening up for this week, and we filled up within 2 days. The service is very needed here, especially to our Native American women in the community.
The services are limited to enrolled Oglala Sioux tribal members. The clinic was funded through an agreement with OST, Rosebud, and Cheyenne River Sioux tribes. Earlier this year, Rosebud and Cheyenne River pulled their funding, citing concerns the clinic had not seen patients for over a year. Enrolled Rosebud and Cheyenne River members now go to Oyate Health Clinic for women's health services. Oglala Sioux Tribal President Frank Starr comes out, says it's unfortunate the other tribes pulled out. He says OST found resources to reopen Native Women's Health Clinic.
And I'm glad it's finally happening. It's great. This is going to be huge, I believe, in the future because of the need. I'm looking forward to seeing that in the future for our membership.
Starr comes out, says he's confident the clinic will remain open beyond his administration. For National Native News, I'm Lee Strubinger.
A new report shows that police youth apprenticeship programs can help interest young people in careers in law enforcement, which can help offset a recent trend in hiring and retaining officers in understaffed departments. Will Walkie reports.
Many forces offer programs that provide on-the-job training alongside classroom instruction. Benjamin Klosky was an apprentice in Northern Virginia. He says he became interested because he didn't want to go to college or the military after graduating high school and still needed to earn a wage.
If you ask a police officer what they do, they'll tell you they're everything from a marriage counselor to a social worker to a teacher to, you know, a referee. They have to inhabit a bunch of different roles, and not all of those roles are learned within the confines of the police academy.
Klosky still had to go through a vetting process, including a polygraph and background check, and he was able to do productive police work, like helping run the warrant desk, handling evidence, and performing maintenance, along with shadowing patrol shifts. He says apprenticeships are costly for departments, but they can provide benefits like increasing officer retainment, saving money compared to the academies, and recruiting more diverse workers. For instance, many of Klosky's fellow cadets spoke multiple languages and came from a variety of socioeconomic backgrounds.
The other cadets were not people who would have otherwise gone to college and then become police officers. These are people from the communities that are being policed who wanted to become police officers and didn't have another route to do so.
Officer hiring and retention has struggled since 2020 amid rising public distrust in policing and concerns over excessive force among officers. However, that trend may be starting to reverse for the first time since the pandemic, according to the Police Executive Research Forum. For Public News Service, I'm Will Walkie.
California voters will get to weigh in this November on the issue of crime and sentencing. Proposition 36 on the November ballot would ramp up penalties for repeat theft and fentanyl-related drug crimes, making changes to the state's Prop 47. Formerly incarcerated activists and legislative allies held a news conference urging people to organize against the new ballot measure. Christopher Martinez reports.
The November elections have been described as a turning point that will set the stage for years to come. That holds true not only for the presidential elections, but for some of the down-ballot races, including ballot measures like California's Proposition 36. That's a law and order measure aimed at raising penalties for certain crimes like repeat theft and fentanyl drug crimes. Some Democratic lawmakers have come out against the proposition, and so too have people with past criminal records who are trying to go straight. Tanish Hollins is director of the group Californians for Safety and Justice.
We are a part of the public safety solution. We do not need to go back to tough on crime. It didn't work.
Hollins and other activists held a news conference at the state capitol in Sacramento to oppose Prop 47 on the November ballot. Democratic State Senator Maria Elena Durazo of Los Angeles lent her support to the activists.
No matter how much some people try, we will not go back. That is what a certain person on the national level is saying. We will not go back. We're not going back to overly punitive approaches that of the past that left our prisons overcrowded and our communities less safe. We will not go back to a failed criminal justice system, policies of the past that voters have repeatedly rejected. The reality is, we will not go back.
The activists are opposing Proposition 36, a measure on the November ballot that would increase penalties for some theft and drug crimes. It was put on the ballot largely in response to the fentanyl epidemic and a rash of mass shoplifting. The proposition would make changes to the voter-approved Prop 47 that reduced sentences and lowered some crimes like shoplifting from felonies to misdemeanors as a way of dealing with California's prison population problem. But activists are pushing back against the new measure. Democratic Assemblymember Isaac Bryan of Los Angeles says we cannot go back to the good old days of mass incarceration.
In fact, we spend more on prisons than we do on just about any other state infrastructure. Even right now, at a time where our prison population is half of what it used to be, we are still spending record high instead of investing in communities. Instead of putting people away for longer and longer periods of time, we should be making the investments that keep people from going to prison in the first place, the same kind of investments that allow people to rebuild their lives when they get home.
Activist Ingrid Archie works with the Oakland-based group Time Done. She says she spent 18 years on parole and probation, and Prop 47 programs were what got her help.
And so they tell us this lie that once we get something on our record, that that is the stain. That is the lie from the pits of hell. We are not a stain. We are people.
Now, she says we have to take down barriers to giving people a second chance to rebuild their lives, their families, and their communities. And that, she says, means not rolling back Prop 47.
So when you make a commitment with things like Prop 47 to invest in communities, you don't get to roll that back. And so, no, we're not going back. We're moving forward. We are Time Done. We are over 200,000 people nationally. There are 8 million people in California that are living with the old record. And we are going to make sure that all 8 million gain access to being able to expunge their records so that they can get a sustainable job and they can take agency and being able to take care of their families. That's who we are. We are people who take care of our families, we take care of our communities, and we want agency to take care of ourselves. It wasn't the system that saved us, it's us, and it is us who are going to continue to save us, and you don't get to tell us to go back. We moving forward, period.
Reporting for Pacifica Radio News KPFA, I'm Christopher Martinez.
Staff at San Francisco Superior Court say they are on the verge of striking. This in response to what they say are staffing shortages so extreme, they're beginning to negatively impact defendants' Sixth Amendment right to a speedy trial. Emily Burris reports.
San Francisco Superior Court staff say they are stretched too thin to properly do their jobs, with high numbers of vacancies and heavy caseloads. They rallied outside of the city's Hall of Justice and Superior Court in an effort to get court management to address these issues. Recently, court officials dismissed 70 misdemeanor cases after courtroom delays pushed the trials past their constitutional deadline. Robert Borders spoke outside of the Hall of Justice, where he works as a courtroom clerk. He says that workers in the courts are having to do tasks they're not trained to do, and these have real-world consequences.
Sometimes these little mistakes, these little training, gaps in training, will cause somebody to stay in jail all weekend when they shouldn't stay in jail. Will cause somebody to be released when they're not supposed to be released. Will delay somebody's trial.
Border said a meeting was scheduled with court management to discuss negotiations, but management canceled it at the last second. He said that when workers went to management with their concerns, they were ignored. According to Borders, this is not usual in the court system.
So many times I've been in the courtroom and other attorneys from other counties, other judges from other counties, they say, why is it done like this? What is this? And the answer is always just, that's the way that we do it.
Benjamin Thompson is also a courtroom clerk at the SF Hall of Justice. He said to the crowd of workers that it is of the utmost importance for court staff to unite if they want to see change. The workers later chanted that they are willing to strike and that their union is mighty. SF Superior Court Staff Union is a part of the Service Employees International Union's Northern California chapter. Standing with this group, Thompson said they have to be united to bargain with management.
If we are not united and we go below 50% plus one in terms of support of our union, oh my God, the first thing they're going to do is knock us down to minimum wage.
In a press release from SEIU, Thompson said that in an internal survey taken by 75% of court workers, 65% said that vacancies and short staffing are affecting their work. Thompson urged workers to collect evidence for their union members or bargaining teams of things like being given tasks they were not trained for or that are outside of their purview. And he said that the workers' presence should encourage co-workers to join next time the union has a rally. Court staff say they could strike, quote, if provoked. According to SEIU, contract negotiations will begin right after Labor Day. The union says, though it's early to speculate on a strike, it would happen after court staff's current contract expires at the end of September. I'm Emily Burris, Pacifica Radio, KPFA.
Mexican President Andrés Manuel López Obrador is facing mounting pressure against his controversial proposal to overhaul the Mexican judicial system, which would require judges to be elected, among other proposals. Judges and magistrates today joined a strike begun early this week by federal court employees to oppose the proposal, while Morgan Stanley and other financial institutions warned that the overhaul could pose serious market consequences and risks for potential investors in Mexico. In response to rising criticism, President-elect Claudia Sheinbaum joined her political ally López Obrador in defending the proposal today. López Obrador, a populist leader whose six-year term ends at the end of September, has long been at odds with Mexican courts. He contends judges are part of a, quote, mafia against him, and says the proposal is meant to clean up corruption. López Obrador has gone on winding rants against the Mexican judicial system, ignored court orders, and publicly sparred with judges whose rulings he's disagreed with. Among the changes sought by López Obrador is to have judges be elected and allow virtually anyone with a law degree and a few years' experience as a lawyer to become a judge through a popular vote. Given major electoral wins by López Obrador's Morena party in June elections, many academics have voiced concerns that selecting judges by popular vote would put politically biased judges on the bench and deal a blow to checks and balances in the Mexican government. The striking court employees also fear the measure would put their careers in danger. Since Monday, thousands of employees have camped outside federal court buildings, and the rallies grew today with judges and magistrates joining in. The demonstrators gathered under tents, chanting and holding protest signs, with Mexicans with court appointments turned away. Independent presidential candidate Robert F. Kennedy Jr. will speak Friday about what he calls the present historical moment and his path forward. His campaign announced the speech today, fueling growing speculation that Kennedy could drop out and support Republican presidential nominee former President Trump. Kennedy's running mate openly discussed the possibility on a podcast this week. Nicole Shanahan said the campaign was considering a move to, quote, join forces with Trump to limit the possibility of Democratic Vice President Kamala Harris winning the election. Kennedy is a member of the beloved Democratic dynasty, the nephew of the late President John F. Kennedy and son of Robert Kennedy. New England conservationists are pushing for permanent protections for the environmentally sensitive Cassius Ledge area in the Gulf of Maine. More from Catherine Carley.
Often called the Yellowstone of the North Atlantic, it contains rare ecological structures, a treasure trove of marine life, and one of the deepest cold water kelp forests along the eastern seaboard. Priscilla Brooks with the Conservation Law Foundation says giving the area sanctuary status would allow for needed scientific research in one of the fastest warming bodies of water on the planet.
Protecting Tasha Sledge is one of the most comprehensive opportunities for biodiversity and climate stewardship in the Gulf of Maine.
Hundreds of scientists and ocean advocacy groups have officially requested permanent protections from the Biden administration, the first step in what's expected to be a years-long process. Most commercial fishing, including bottom trawlers, is already restricted in the Cache's Ledge area to help restore depleted groundfish populations like cod and haddock. But conservation groups say regulatory uncertainty and a change in the White House could undo protections already in place. Brooks says the economic health of Maine's coastal communities relies on a healthy ocean ecosystem that can adapt to the growing stress of climate change.
More diverse ecological communities and healthy communities can provide an insurance policy that ecosystem functionings will be maintained even if some species decline.
Brooks says multiple industries, fishing, aquaculture, and tourism have a stake in preserving Cache's Ledge. She says a newly designated sanctuary would also contribute to President Biden's goal of conserving 30% of America's lands and waters by 2030 to slow biodiversity loss and build climate resilience. For Public News Service, I'm Catherine Carley.
Guatemalan police have arrested seven Guatemalans accused of having smuggled 53 migrants from Mexico and Central America who died of asphyxiation in 2022 in Texas after being abandoned in a tractor trailer in the scorching summer heat. They were the latest arrests after years of investigation into one of the deadliest human smuggling attempts to the United States. Interior Minister Francisco Jimenez told the Associated Press the arrests included the alleged ringleader of the smuggling gang whose extradition has been requested by the United States. Six people were charged previously, including two men from Texas, arrested shortly after the migrants were found. An attorney for Hunter Biden has accused prosecutors of wanting to introduce salacious details about partying and spending by President Joe Biden's son to smear his character in front of jurors at his upcoming trial on federal tax charges. During a lengthy hearing in Los Angeles federal court, Hunter Biden's lawyer said special counsel David Weiss's team was intent on, quote, character assassination by seeking to bring in such evidence in the case alleging Hunter Biden failed to pay at least $1.4 million in taxes. The comments came as the defense and prosecution sparred for hours over what evidence and testimony jurors should be allowed to hear when the trial begins early next month. A new report suggests that food banks help to reduce greenhouse gas-causing carbon emissions. Eric Tegetoff reports.
The Global Food Banking Network's annual impact report finds food banks around the world stopped 1.8 million metric tons of carbon emissions last year by preventing food from going to waste in landfills. The network includes food banks in more than 50 countries. Rachel Lucille with Oregon Food Bank says food waste is the result of food that's both inaccessible and unaffordable.
When we, as in food banks, work with local growers to intercept perfectly good edible food before it's thrown out, that helps to mitigate harmful greenhouse gas emissions created by food waste.
Food waste in landfills is a major source of methane, a potent greenhouse gas that captures heat at a higher rate than carbon dioxide over a 20-year period. About one in eight Oregonians faces food insecurity, meaning they aren't sure where their next meal will come from. Carbon emissions from food waste exacerbate climate change, and the impact from there is circular. Lucille says wildfires across Oregon are affecting food production.
Extreme weather events caused by climate change disrupt food supply chains that lead to increased and unpredictable pricing of food, increased risk of food deserts for the communities that are already facing food insecurity, and fewer fresh fruits and vegetables.
One way to fight food waste is through support of small local agriculture, which Lucille says their organization does through its Community Producer Support Project. They say small farmers help fight climate change.
It contributes to biodiversity, uses sustainable farming practices, and keeps food local, which reduces fossil fuel emissions related to packaging and transportation of food.
I'm Eric Tegetoff reporting.
A new study shows that more than 1 million tons of animal waste are produced each year at factory farms, and it's having an effect on public health. Terry D. reports.
Consumers' desire for more animal protein and better efficiency to reduce world hunger are a few of the reasons for the increase in concentrated animal feeding operations. Opponents say the emissions produced by CAFOs pose a risk to public health. Confined animal manure, waste, and urine fall into slatted floors into a manure pit and are then piped into a pond or manure lagoon. Queen Mary University of London Global Public Health graduate Elise Pohl explains the disposal process.
And then they take that manure and they pipe it into trucks to fertilize land. While it is sitting in that lagoon, it emits several different components: ammonia, hydrogen sulfide, methane, endotoxins, carbon dioxide.
Pohl says the facilities usually have no ventilation system which permits particulate matter to float in the air amidst feces and dust. The Illinois Environmental Council says the state has 30,000 livestock operations, including an estimated 500 large CAFOs, one of the highest numbers of large-scale factory farms in the country. Large-scale ag producers say they are trying to meet consumer demand and are constantly looking for ways to be more environmentally friendly. Research has shown that employees exposed to manure pit gases have higher rates of respiratory illnesses. As many as 70% of exposed workers developed acute bronchitis due to a lack of occupational health and safety measures. Pohl says the health risks do not stop there.
The frontline workers that are exposed to things like avian influenza and antimicrobial resistant genes, and they can take that home, expose their family and friends, and then it's further spread into the community.
The study shows that residents living near CAFOs had higher rates of infant mortality, and adults were diagnosed with more cases of tuberculosis, anemia, kidney disease, and increased rates of hospital admissions than residents living in zip codes with no swine CAFOs. I'm Terry D. reporting.
The state of Idaho has the fewest doctors per capita of any state in the nation. But experts say technology could be used to help the state attract and retain more doctors and nurses. More from Eric Tegedoff.
The up-and-coming healthcare workforce could benefit from technology's integration into education, especially in rural states like Idaho, says Dr. Teresa Connor, the former dean of Idaho State University's College of Health.
Recruiting our own and training people in their communities where they've grown up and they love the community, they have ties, and technology's really helping us address that equation of how to get providers into rural communities through really the resource they already have, their people.
Connor is now dean of the College of Health and Human Services at North Dakota State University. She says expanded communication technologies help people across vast distances connect, enabling remote learning in rural places. Connor says another important technology is simulations. She says while she was at Idaho State University, grant funding from the Idaho Workforce Development Council and Portant of Health Trust helped expand these tools. Connor says these are going to be important to healthcare education.
One of the great parts about this is it creates a safe failure. So it's okay in a simulation if they get the wrong answer or they fail, because no one gets harmed, and then they can debrief and learn from that mistake.
Connor says simulation technology also could help with the biggest bottleneck in healthcare education, which is the limited number of clinical placements. She notes that this technology won't replace real-world education, but she says it does provide an opportunity to show students important situations they might not see during their clinical experience.
Through simulation, we can make sure that students are exposed to a range of different kinds of cases that we want all of them exposed to.
I'm Eric Tegedoff reporting.
A former Minneapolis police officer convicted in the death of George Floyd was released from prison yesterday. Thomas Lane pleaded guilty in 2022 to state charges of aiding and abetting second-degree manslaughter. He was sentenced to 3 years in prison. A federal jury convicted Lane that same year, as well as two other former officers, for violating Floyd's civil rights when they failed to intervene as their colleague Derek Chauvin kneeled on Floyd's neck for more than 9 minutes, killing him in May of 2020. Lane was sentenced to 2.5 years in prison for the federal charges. The sentences ran concurrently. Chauvin was convicted on murder charges and sentenced to 22.5 years in prison. Yesterday, he was moved to a federal prison in Big Springs, Texas. Chauvin was stabbed 22 times at a federal prison in an incident in Phoenix last November. Brazil will begin imposing restrictions on the entry of some foreign citizens from Asia seeking refuge in the South American nation as a means to migrate to the United States and Canada. The Justice Ministry's press office said today that the restrictions will begin on Monday and will affect Asian migrants who require visas to remain in Brazil. A federal police investigation has shown these migrants often buy flights with layovers in Sao Paulo's international airport en route to other destinations, but stay in Brazil as means to begin their journey north. A new partnership is making it easier for students at Dallas College in Texas to transfer to a four-year university in the Lone Star State. Frieda Ross reports.
The college has joined forces with Texas A&M University Commerce, Texas Woman's University, and the University of North Texas, Dallas to form the Dallas Transfer Collaborative. Dallas College Chancellor Justin Lennon says a new hub connects all four institutions to a centralized portal, streamlining the transfer process.
And then it also provides technology that will allow students to go, hey, you know, here are the courses that I've taken at Dallas College, and here's how those courses will plug into these broad array of programs at these universities.
The program is partially funded by the Commit Partnerships Opportunity 2040 Fund, which aims to reduce child poverty in Dallas County by half and double the number of young adults making a living wage. More than 64,000 students are enrolled in the 7 Dallas College campuses. Lennon says they hope the hub will help more of those students continue their education after leaving community college.
Nearly half of our students come to us and say they have an intent to transfer, but only about 1 in 4 does so over a 3-year time period. And so again, there can be many reasons for that, but what we don't want is for there to be institutional barriers between our university partners.
Lennon says they hope to add more universities to the group and that the program will be a model for other universities across the country. For Public News Service, I'm Frieda Ross.
A new government report concludes that fluoride in drinking water at twice the recommended limit is linked with lower IQ in children. The report, based on an analysis of previously published research, marks the first time a federal agency has concluded that there is a link between higher levels of fluoride exposure and lower IQs in kids. Fluoride strengthens teeth and reduces cavities by replacing minerals lost during normal wear and tear. The addition of low levels of fluoride to drinking water has long been considered one of the greatest public health achievements of the last century. Hurricane Gilma has strengthened to a Category 2 hurricane in the eastern Pacific Ocean. The National Hurricane Center says the system had maximum sustained winds of 105 miles per hour today. Gilma is centered nearly 1,000 miles west-southwest of the southern tip of the Baja California Peninsula of Mexico. There are no coastal watches or warnings in effect. Gilma had strengthened to a tropical storm status on Sunday. The storm was moving west-northwest at 7 miles per hour. Forecasters say it could become a Category 4 hurricane by tomorrow afternoon.
A survey of international students looking to enroll at U.S. colleges and universities may base their decision on whether to come and study here on the outcome of the November election. Terry D. reports.
Almost 27,000 international students are enrolled at Indiana's universities. The survey of almost 2,500 foreign students found 44% would be more likely to choose the United States as a college destination under a Democratic administration, which they perceived as a more welcoming cultural environment. But Caitlin Anderson, founder of a graduate admission consulting firm, says others would feel more at ease with a Republican administration.
30% of people that said they would be more likely to consider studying the U.S. under a Trump presidency said that the reason was because it's inspiring us because there'll be more jobs, there'll be more opportunities, and he'll be less focused on intervening in international affairs.
About one-third of the respondents said politics will not make a difference in their college choice. Anderson says many foreign students come here to pursue STEM degrees. More also are seeking graduate business courses at Ivy League universities that are, in turn, actively recruiting international students. Anderson says foreign students come to the U.S. to advance their careers and build an international network.
They're just really passionate about doing that, and that's actually something that is very true across cultures. The other motivator was going to be they bring skills back to their homes, to their families, and use it in their home countries.
She notes universities are reforming their review process by actively using artificial intelligence to provide an unbiased application process. The goal is to uncover information before a human admissions staffer sees a student's name or information that could reveal their country of origin. I'm Terry D. reporting.
After a Tesla semi caught fire and left Interstate 80 in a chokehold this week, California lawmakers are calling on Governor Gavin Newsom to delay a state mandate for big rigs in the state to be all electric by 2045. Along the freeway east of Nyack in Placer County, traffic stretched for miles as crews tried to extinguish the Tesla fire. The CHP said another issue at play was the toxic fumes being emitted from the vehicle. CAL FIRE said its crew members had to wait for the lithium-ion batteries to die, burn themselves out, and cool down to 100 degrees. Road officials also had to shut down the roadway because the fire spread to nearby brush. Aircraft dropped fire retardant around the semi to keep the flames from continuing to spread. In all, the process for putting out the fire took hours. It also did not help that fire crews have little experience in dealing with electric vehicle fires, which are much more challenging than fires started from a gas-powered vehicle. This did not go unnoticed by California Republicans, who on Tuesday issued a letter calling for Newsom to put his advanced clean fleets mandate on hold. The governor issued a mandate in 2020 that would require all big rig trucks to be electric within the next two decades.
It'll be clear tonight in the San Francisco Bay Area, lows tonight around 60. Tomorrow, sunny with highs in the 60s and 70s. In the central San Joaquin Valley, clear tonight, lows in the 60s there. Sunny tomorrow, highs in the 80s. That's it for the news. With Scott Baba, I'm Max Pringle. Rod Akeel is at the controls. Good evening.
Hi, this is Mitch Jezrich. Democracy Now! Is bringing us a two-hour special each day from the Democratic Convention in Chicago. That means no letters on politics. However, I will be hosting an 11 a.m. special just after Democracy Now!'s coverage, in which we'll open up the phone line so that you can talk about the election, you and me, at 11 a.m. on KPFA. Try not to be late.
Listening to 94.1 KPFA Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, 94.3 K232FZ Monterey, and online at kpfa.org.